Me too. We're almost through with the Sermon on the Mount. There's a flyer in your bulletin, because next Sunday you're going to hear five different speakers next Sunday. They're going to be answering those questions in the bulletin. And so you might want to read that passage and ponder those questions this week and come ready to hear next Sunday, as we have five different people going to share, and I guess I'll be number six. So that's next Sunday as we finishing out the Sermon on the Mount. To me, it's been a great journey, because the journey through the Sermon on the Mount is excellent for Christian living. You know, because if we're not doing what he tells us on the Mount, because this is Jesus telling us, this is how you do it. This is how you live your life. You know, this is the attitude that you should have. You know, this is the these are things that you shouldn't do, like murder and, you know, judging and things like that. But he just goes through so much with us in this. And today, I titled the message, Fruit Check. We're going to check our fruit today. Amen. How many of you produce fruit? Some of you won't raise your hand no matter what. Okay. I'll tell you what the fruit is in a few minutes. So why don't you stand with me? We'll read the word out of Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 to 20. You will know them by their fruits. Verse 15. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Dear Heavenly Father, as we go through this passage, Lord, of examining fruit, and Lord, even talking about prophets, Father God, I pray that, Lord, that we would all have a great understanding of what the fruit is today. That, Lord, and producing it in our own lives, Lord, not just looking at prophets, but, Lord, that we could look in the mirror today of our own lives and examine ourselves, Father, to see if we're in the way. Lord, that we are in the way with Jesus. And, Lord, that you would just minister to us by the Holy Spirit today. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. You may be seated. You know, we had a great week this past week. John Emiliano Harkey, you know, they are a wonderful gift to the body of Christ. Their prophetic ministry is very accurate. You know, it's just even the people I didn't know, I went and I asked them. I said, hey, what they said, did it bear witness? And they're like, oh yeah, it's like, you know, we had a pastor's meeting out here on Tuesday, last Tuesday, and I invited pastors from around the city to come, and we had one gentleman that come for the EV Free Church, and he'd never seen a prophet. And the prophet called him out and ministered to him and prophesied to him. And this guy was blown away. He's like, man, he's like, he knew. And I'm like, amen. He's like, I believe in prophets now. I'm like, wow. You know, because John and Emiliano, they produce good fruit. You know, they're loving, they're kind, they're gentle, you know, and they care very much for people, care about this nation a lot. And that's why when God called them to go on the road, and they spend 365 days a year on the road ministering. You know, they have a home that's rented out, they live in hotels, because they believe God wants to do something great in America yet. You know, and as we've been going through the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is winding it down. We're coming to the end of it. But he gives us an explicit warning about prophets that do not produce fruit. And Jesus knows that there's a great deception coming, the falling away of the saints. You know, as I contemplated this message last night and was praying, I began thinking about all the things that the body of Christ buys into. The things that we're spending our money on. Now, you don't have to raise your hand, but how many of you bought the books on the blood moons? How many of you bought books on how to get through the year 2000, Y2K? You know, the stuff that people are saying, the prophets that are saying, all this stuff about all this junk that never happened. And are you complaining when it doesn't happen because you spent your hard-earned money on a book that didn't amount to nothing? I think, oh my gosh, man, so much money was spent on Blood Moon books. So much money, but then nothing happened. I didn't buy one. I didn't read one. I mean, I looked at it. I looked at some stuff online, but, you know, people are creating things today that prophets are creating things today that are putting fear in the body of Christ. And we're not to have fear. Fear is of the enemy, amen? Fear is of the devil. Fear brings torment, the word says. Perfect love casts out what? All fear. So God's not intending for us to be in fear. Now, I know we need to be aware, but when we're putting out stuff that's bringing fear on the body of Christ, whether it be stories on the internet or books that are being pushed out, I got a question. Why do we even bother with them? Because fear is rampant right now in America. You know, I saw a post on Facebook the other day, you know, that when they bombed when they crashed the planes in the World Trade Center, and now we're afraid to say anything against the Muslims. What happened? What happened? I remember going to New York. I remember going to Ground Zero. I remember seeing the big American flag on Wall Street, on the building. And I remember reading the signs. We will never forget. But yet, a few years later, they're doing parades. The Muslims are doing parades down the street of New York City, and they're celebrating. See, all that is a sign for them, the victory. That's all what it represents. So we've backed way off. America is coming to a place of fear and bowing down to the enemies of America to the point that, you know, our president bows down to other kings now. So, you know, I mean, things have gotten out of control, but the body of Christ has gotten out of control too. We're bowing down to the world system these days. Thessalonians tells us this, 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. He says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. See, this stuff's going to happen. It's going to come, amen? There's going to be a great falling away. And I remember Pastor Dave came and talked to you about apostasy in September because I believe that the apostasy is already happening. I believe the great falling away is already happening because we're buying into all these prophetic things that are being said out there that aren't biblical. They pull a scripture here, they pull a scripture there, and they back it up by circumstances. And we can't do that. We've got to back it up with the Word of God. But I believe that in the church and in America, there's a buying into the world system. The church is saying homosexuality is okay. The church is saying that living together is okay. The church is saying that having sex outside of marriage is okay. There is so much that the church is saying. Now, when I talk about the church, when I say church, who am I talking about? Am I talking about a denomination? Am I talking about an organization? Am I talking about a building? Who am I talking about when I say the church? Us, people, the people of God. See, when the people of God, you know, hear it from the pulpit that same-sex marriage is wrong because according to the Word, that sex outside of marriage is wrong according to the Word, that abortion is wrong according to the Word, but yet the body of Christ does it, then we're saying we don't care what God says, we care about what we want to do. See, and that's where a lot of the church, we've gotten off. We bought into the world system. And I say we buy into the world system because we're participating in what the world does. And we're saying it's okay. And it's totally contrary to the Word of God. I remember we had a lady here one time. Because when around election time, you'll hear me talk about biblical principles according to the Word of God. And she told me one time, and she's not here, she's gone to be with Jesus. But she told me one day, she said, "You know, Pastor, I love your preaching." She goes, "But I hate when you talk about politics." I said, "When have I ever talked about politics?" She said, "Well, you talked about this and this." I said, "That's not political. That's biblical. I'm just telling you the truth. If you don't like the truth according to the Word, because this person told me, well, I vote this way because they're going to get jobs. They're going to line up jobs." And I said, "Since when is the government my provider? I thought Jehovah Jireh was my provider. I thought the Lord God was my provider. You know, I'm not looking for government support. Amen. I'm looking for the Lord's support. Amen. I'm looking for God to do something. Not that the world would offer us anything. I mean, you know, what does the Bible say? If a man doesn't work, he doesn't eat. Jesus worked. I mean, the Lord God our Father, He works how many days a week? 6. I never complain about working 6 days a week. I'm just happy to have a job, amen? No one deceive you. I met a man the other day. Well, I've known him for a while, but I got to talk to him. He's from Bethlehem. He has a home there in Bethlehem. He's told me, "You could go and stay." I said, "Oh, that side of the line is probably not good for me." But I asked him, you know, well, he said his daughter was getting married in Bethlehem and he'd be going over there. I'm like, "Wow, that's great, you know." And he said, "You know," he says, "our kids are not like Americans." I said, "What do you mean?" He says, "I decide who my kids marry." I said, "It's arranged?" He says, "It's not arranged, but my kids don't date. They meet a person, we interview them, and we ask about their family, we ask about the problem in their family, we ask about the issues of life in their family, and if it's too bad, we tell our kids, 'You can't marry this person.'" I thought, wow, that'd be great, but the church does what they want. I know I'm stepping on your toes today, because I want us all to go to heaven, amen. That's the objective. His kids listen to him. He says they're not allowed to date like in America and go around and open doors in their life that don't need to be open. And the church has become the opposite of that. Most people do what they want. I put in my notes here, and wait till a prophet comes to hear from God. But when people are doing what they want, they don't come to hear from the prophet, they stay away from him. Because when people are doing what they want, man, when I was younger, I'd be like, "Lord, I mean, we got this prophet coming to the church. Lord, is there anything in me that you need to deal with? Because I don't want him to point it out in front of everybody. Lord, you know, there could be something in me that I need to deal with today." And I would search my heart, Juwan. I'd be like, "Please don't point out anything wrong in me, man. You know, if you got something wrong, you know, take me aside." You know, but I've never... You know, like John Harkey, he's just so loving and kind, you know. He takes the mic away if it's something that's really personal. But, you know, we always get afraid. And a lot of people stay away from prophetic meetings. Man, those words that he preached were great this week. They're all online on the New Hope Family Worship YouTube page. They're all online. You can listen to them all. I was in a meeting one time. The prophet was just speaking and just rambling for hours. Hours. I'm thinking, "Oh my gosh." And I'm thinking, people got to be leaving, you know. And I turn around and everybody's still there. I thought, what in the world? But the thing that I've come to find out is people will stick around and put up with garbage just so they can get a word from God. And you know what? That breaks my heart. I was in a Benny Hinn meeting one time. And they said, we're going to pray for the pastors. Benny Hinn was going to lay hand on the pastors. And man, my friend's like, go down there, Ron, you're a pastor. I'm like, oh, all right, man. So I got up and I went down there. And, you know, I don't get pushed around easy. But these pastors, man, they were pushing and pulling and tugging. And I wasn't even trying to just push back. I was just getting pushed around. And I'm looking at the ushers, and the ushers, they're yelling at the ushers to try and get on stage. You know, the pastors were being so mean. I stood there and I just started crying. I said, Lord, what is going on? He said, they're trying to get from a man what I want to give them. But they're not willing to do what it takes to get it. See, that's a lot that happens with prophetic ministry. We don't want to take time to hear from God. We want somebody else to tell us. So I got a few points I want to point out to you today. And number one, it's right out of the scripture. Beware of false prophets. Beware of false prophets. Everybody wants to see signs and wonders. And I've seen in the body of Christ, people follow after that, which is wrong. You don't follow after signs and wonders. Can I hear an amen? You follow after Jesus. And when you follow Jesus, He confirms the Word with signs and wonders. See, you follow Jesus. Now, just because a person can perform miracles doesn't mean that we should follow them. Deuteronomy tells us this in chapter 13, verse 1. It says, if there arises among you a prophet or a dreamer of dreams, and he gives you a sign and a wonder, and the sign of the wonder comes to pass of which he spoke to you, saying, let us go after other gods which you have not known, and let us serve them. And you shall not listen. Everybody say, shall not. Listen to the words of that prophet or that dreamer of dreams. For the Lord your God is testing you to know whether you love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul. See, so just following somebody because they can do a sign and a wonder is wrong. Following signs and wonders ministries, I put the enemy of our soul, the devil, is counterfeiting God to deceive the people of God. And this takes us into the next point, point number two. Signs and wonders don't make the prophet. It doesn't make them a prophet. Doesn't make them a good prophet because they do signs and wonders. 1 Corinthians 13:2, it says, though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I can remove mountains, but have not love, I'm nothing. Prophecy, understanding, knowledge, faith, remove mountains. We would say that that is a powerful man of God. But there's one missing element in him that makes him a man of God. There's one element that will get him into heaven. That missing element is what will make number three today. I'm just jamming along today. One, two, three. And that missing element is fruit. If they profess Christ, they need to show fruit. Amen? Now, let's stop talking about them and let's talk about us. If we profess Christ, we need to show fruit. I put in my notes here, if they're going to speak for God, they need to show fruit. Without it, they are nothing. And what is the fruit that needs to be seen? Love. Love. I believe the fruit of the Spirit is love. And the next eight complement how we're to love. If you don't love, then you don't reveal Christ. You can't be mean one minute and loving the next and think that you're of God. It doesn't work that way. What did he say? He said, even so, verse 17, even so, every good tree bears good fruit, and a bad tree bears bad fruit. Listen, a good tree cannot bear bad fruit, and a bad tree cannot bear good fruit. You're either one or the other. You're either producing one or the other. You can't say, well, I'm loving most of the time. Isn't that what it's saying? You can't say, well, I love most of the time, or how about I'm patient sometimes. You can't have it both ways. And the word that's used here for fruit is the same thing that's used in Galatians chapter 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit, everybody say fruit. Fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law. Self-control. That's the fruit. That's the evidence of our love. We have self-control. Amen? The evidence of our love is that we walk in joy. The evidence of our love is that we walk in peace. It doesn't mean that I can be all peaceful and loving and joyful here at church and then go home and kick the cat, because that's all we have is a cat, and be mean to my wife. It doesn't work. But how many of us have got in the car, left church, and then fought all the way home? Love is the fruit that the prophet needs to show. Love is the fruit that we need to show. I say love because when we love, all the other things will come with it. We'll walk in joy, we'll walk in peace, we'll walk in long-suffering or patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. We'll just walk in those things if we love. If we err on the side of love always, we'll be peaceful people. Amen? It's a natural flow of the love at work in us and through us. Now, when Pastor Jesse and I went to China last year, we were in China last year in October, we were at a conference. We had 450 house church pastors and leaders. And so all these pastors, we had one other speaker that was there with us for a day and a half. And he was speaking, and it was our turn to rest. Because I would bust off 4 hours in the morning preaching. After lunch, and then Jesse would go, and then this other guy would go. But when that other guy would go, me and Jesse would go to the room and rest because I would be tired. And because we would speak from 8 in the morning till 5 in the evening every day. And we did this for 5 days. But in the middle of the week, all these pastors, they had a prayer room. Now, this prayer room was incredible. It was a prayer building. It was round. And you walked in, and there was a stairwell in the center of the room. It was 3 stories tall. And when you walked in, there was doors all the way around the room. And each door opened up. It was just a closet with a kneeling pad, so that the people could go in there and get on their knees before the Lord and pray. So you go to the second floor, doors all the way around. Again, just rooms. You go up to the third, incredible prayer room. It'd be great like out in the hills out there, Rick, where you live, you know. It's a big old prayer. Because we're out in the middle of a cornfield. You go up to the third floor, and it was a giant room. And they had mats and stuff up there. So they came to the room that we were resting in, and they said, the pastors would like you to come and prophesy to them all. I said, really? That's wonderful, you know. And so I went up there and I said, it's not what I do. I'm not here to prophesy to you. I'm here to teach you to prophesy. So I did. I got them to where everybody got a prophetic word and they did it all. It was an incredible time. They were so encouraged by the time they were done. And then I just prayed for all of them as a whole. You know, because, you know, everybody wants to hear from God, but my job is to teach you how to do it for yourself. And the way we did it was, I had everybody write their name down on a piece of paper. I collected them, I shuffled them, I handed them back out. I said, don't look at the name. I said, I want you to pray, I want you to hear from heaven, and I want you to write down what you hear. And then we handed them, then we collected them again, and we handed them back out to whose paper it was. Man, people were crying. People were just tore up, man, because God just spoke to them. But when Pastor Jesse and I were there, what we taught on was the fruit. Everybody wants the gifts. Everybody wants the power of God. But we spent 5 days going through the 9 fruits. We did whole sermons on just one fruit. We took turns: love, joy, peace, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, patience. We just, one at a time, we went through. We spent hours teaching them on the fruit. Because listen, if you're not going to produce fruit, don't prophesy. If you're not going to be loving, just be quiet. It'd be better for you. We took those 9 fruit, man, and we just ministered them the whole time. Because, listen, being gifted is not a guarantee of heaven. Romans 10:9 says this. It says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you'll be saved. So, love is the biggest outward confession of Christ that you or I can make. See, it's not just words. It's in what you do. It's in loving. That's our confession of Christ. We think, well, I love Jesus with all my heart, my soul, and my mind. And then we go out and we gossip about somebody. No, you don't love Jesus with all your heart, soul, and mind. We go out and we're mean to somebody. You know, where's the love in that? You know, we think that, well, I confess that I love Jesus. No, our confession of faith is in our lifestyle, amen? Our confession of faith is in what we do for a daily basis. Our confession of Christ is in our worship. And I'm not talking about what you sing here on Sundays. I'm talking about what you do on Monday. That's where the confession of Christ comes in. Are you confessing Christ with the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, the kindness, the goodness, the faithfulness, the gentleness, and the self-control? Are you confessing Christ with that? Because that's what matters. We can't just hold prophets accountable to it, because it's for all of us, amen? When we walk in the opposite of these, Galatians 5:21 says, we'll not inherit the kingdom of God. Because we're not confessing Christ. John Harkey, he asked us a question this week. What is the prevailing voice that you listen to for your life? Is it God's voice? Is this your prevailing voice? Is it Satan's voice? The deception he throws at you? Or is it your own voice? Now, I know God speaks to us in prayer and worship and through His Word. But we have to decide what is the prevailing voice in our lives. In our daily Bible reading, I was reading Psalm 66, verse 12. And it talks about how the people went through the fire and through the water. Let me read it to you. Psalms 66. He says, but you've caused men to ride over our heads. We went through fire and through water. But you brought us out to rich fulfillment. And I just kind of felt like as I went through this passage about the fruit, now, some of you have felt like you've been in that fire. You feel like you're being burnt up or burnt out, or you're in that water. You feel like you're drowning, that life has been overtaking you. And in the midst of it all, your love level has gone way down. You're having a hard time connecting, having a hard time connecting in the body of Christ. You're feeling disjointed from the body, and you're overwhelmed by life. But I do know this, that we can submit all of our feelings to the Lord. We can tell Him how we feel and we can give it to Him. Amen. So if you're feeling like I'm not being very loving, we can submit that to the Lord today. If you're feeling like you're not connected, we can submit that to the Lord. If you feel like you're in fire and you're burning up or burning out, we can bring that to the Lord today. If you're feeling like you're drowning, being overwhelmed by the burdens and the cares of this world, we can bring that to the Lord because He is up there interceding for every one of us. And He desires that we produce fruit. His desire is to connect with you so that you can experience His love so that we can love. That's the idea. To have a relationship so that no one can snatch you out of the Lord's hand. Amen? 1 Corinthians 11:27 says this. It says, because we're going to have communion here in a moment. It says, whoever drinks this bread, eats this bread and drinks this cup in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself. So let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. He says, and that's why many sleep amongst you. And you could take that sleep a couple of ways. They either die or they're sleeping. They're not alive in Christ. Because we're not examining ourselves. We just, communion, great. What's your fruit like? How are you loving? Because that's what matters. Today, we could examine the fruit of the prophets. But I think it'd be better if we examined our own lives. If we looked inward, why don't we just do that? Just bow your heads right now. Dear Heavenly Father, we just look in our hearts today. Lord, You know each one of us. You know, Lord, if we've been loving or joyful or peaceful or long-suffering or kind or good or faithful or gentle, or if we've been walking in self-control. And You know, Lord, if we have not. Lord, You loved us first so that we could really love. You gave Jesus so that we could experience the love of the Father. Lord, You have done so much for us to give us the way, the truth, and the life that we could really love. And I pray today, Father, that You would just minister to our hearts, Lord. That we could do a fruit check on our lives right now. Minister to us, Holy Spirit. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Ron, I need you to pray for me. My love level's been real low lately. And I need to just let go of some burdens today and get back where I need to be. If that's you today, just raise your hand so I can pray for you right now. Amen, 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 amen. Anybody else? I'm not going to call you forward. I'm just going to pray for you right now. Father, You've seen these hands that have gone up today. I pray, first of all, Father God, that, Lord, those that feel like they're drowning, or, Lord, that the fire is consuming them, I pray it off today in the name of Jesus. I pray for the love of God to come and fill them and lift them up today in the name of Jesus. I pray that, Lord, that You would infuse our lives with the love of God today. That, Lord, that the weariness that the world would bring us to would just fall by the wayside. And, Lord, that we would not be deceived, Lord, by false prophets. We'd not be deceived by this world. But Lord, that we would not participate in the world's way of doing things. But Lord, that we would pick up Your way. Lord, that we would love God and we would love each other. That Lord, our fruit we would be producing like crazy, God. Because Lord, that we'd be crazy for You. Lord, that we'd be crazy in love with Jesus. And Lord, Your love would abound in our hearts and our minds and our words and our actions, Lord. That You'd give us strength, Lord. I pray today, Father God, that the weights that have been on people, Lord, that you'd lift them today in the name of Jesus. Lord, we just do a burden exchange with you right now, Lord. Pick up our burdens, and Lord, we'll pick up yours, the way of love today. And Lord, that you give us strength to be loving and kind and gentle and peaceable, Father. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Amen. We're ready to partake of the Lord's Supper. Victoria and Robert, come. So why don't you stand with me? This is an open communion. You believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. You confess Him as your Lord and Savior. You're eligible to receive communion today. So why don't you come, get the elements, and then hold on to them, and we'll take it all together in a moment. You know, to partake of the Lord's Supper, it's not just eating a cracker and drinking some juice. To partake in the Lord's Supper, what we're doing is we're partaking in what He's done for us. We're remembering what He's done for us. We're remembering the cross. We're remembering that He took our sin to the cross. He took our sickness and disease to the cross. Amen? And He paid it all for us. That's what we're partaking of. It's not just a cracker and juice. It's life. We're participating in life. Life in the kingdom of God.